So, I hope you like maps, because today we're taking a deep dive into borders. We all know that political borders between states, countries, regions, they have a lot of power over us. They affect our well-being, our economic potential, our loyalties. But there's another set of boundaries overlaid on those political ones, time zones. We don't think much about those borders unless we cross them, by travel or by phone, but we should. And to prove it, we have a couple very different stories about how time zones can also affect our health, our money, or our very identity. Both these stories hinge on one odd question. You know which time zone you live in, but where inside that time zone are you? The world today is divided into 24 strips of longitude, one for each hour of the day. Each zone is theoretically 15 degrees of longitude wide. Before time zones existed, communities kept time largely via one shared standard, the sun. Today, there are two standards, what the sun says and what your time zone dictates, and they can disagree. Take Europe. In theory, this is what you might expect the Central European time zone to look like. It's roughly 15 degrees wide. In the middle, your watch would strike noon more or less when the sun hits its highest point. If you travel to the west, the sun would be a little delayed in reaching you, so solar noon might be 12:30 by your watch, or 11:30 on the eastern end. Point is, you'd never be more than 30 minutes out of sync with the sun. But that's not the actual time zone. This is. In practice, time zones are sloppy, so disparities between clock and solar time can be much worse. If you live in the Galicia region of Spain, solar noon could hit you around 1:45 p.m. And around the world, we see that lots of time zones are a mess. Political borders make many too wide, and lots tend to skew west. The most extreme might be China. It's all one time zone, though it's wide enough to span five. But we'll come back to that in a bit. Time zones are wacky, but we promised you consequences. So here's one, your health. To help explain, we called up an expert with a pretty cool title.
So my name is Eva Winnebeck, and I'm a chronobiologist.
Chronobiologists study the ways that our bodily rhythms synchronize with the day-night cycle. Our sleep patterns, hormones, digestion, blood pressure, temperature, you name it. They're all governed by internal clocks that sync to the sun. They're called our circadian rhythms, circa dies, or about a day in Latin. But modern life throws a monkey wrench into that careful rhythm.
We hide in buildings during the day, and at night we switch on the lights, so we have very little difference between day and night that our biology can interpret. And so we are not so well aligned anymore with the sun.
This scrambling of signals tends to keep us up at night, depriving us of sleep and skewing our schedules later. That's a problem no matter where you live. But here's where time zones matter. If you live on the eastern end of your time zone, the sun wakes you up earlier in the morning and helps you get onto an earlier schedule. But in the west, the sun rises later. It worsens the late schedule that many of us are already on. And the bigger the time zone, the more extreme the effect. Chronobiologists have a term for people living at odds with their biological clock, social jet lag. And it's been correlated with higher risks of health problems, cancers, diabetes, obesity, lots of issues usually associated with aging. A few studies have tied these risks directly to time zones, meaning the time zone border itself may reflect a health divide in an otherwise identical population.
So if you live in the on the eastern end of a time zone, just bordering the western end of the prior time zone, you're an advantage over your neighbors.
Other studies have even calculated an economic cost. One suggests that there's roughly a 3% difference in wages across zone borders. The authors think that it's likely linked to the effect of sleep deprivation on work performance and absenteeism. That same study found that residents on the western edge of a time zone rack up an average of $82 more in healthcare costs each year. To Eva, this all speaks to what we have control over and what we don't.
We thought humans, we are so beyond our biology. We can fight our biology. We don't need to listen to our internal clock. We are in charge. But unfortunately, it turns out, and this is not the case.
There's one other consequence we came across that's very different from the others. It's about that huge single time zone in China. Since 1949, the entire country has followed Beijing time, centered here. And as we know, that's not good news for Western China.
This is a representation of the central government's, you know, ill-advised policies.
Murshad Galip is a native of the Xinjiang region of Western China, though he's now studying linguistic anthropology in the US. Xinjiang is so dramatically far from Beijing that locals there have traditionally done something equally dramatic. They've adopted their own pocket of unique time.
I grew up using Xinjiang time, or local time. It's 2 hours behind Beijing time.
Xinjiang time sidesteps all the problems that come with living in an extreme time zone. The social jet lag, the health issues. It's basically the locals opting out. But there's another wrinkle. Murshid is Uyghur, an ethnic group in Xinjiang that's distinct from the Han Chinese ethnic majority across China. And over the years, more and more Han Chinese have moved to Xinjiang, bringing with them a different culture and Beijing time.
Whenever there's interaction between, you know, like Uyghurs and Han Chinese, especially when there's like time involved, we automatically, we're used to like converting whatever time that they're telling us to Xinjiang time.
Essentially, two independent times exist in Xinjiang, and following one or the other has become an identity marker, a connection to either the local Uyghur community or to the central government in Beijing. But there are larger forces weighing on Xinjiang time, and in the past few years, the whole region's been swept up in a dire and volatile situation. Starting in 2016, the Chinese central government has asserted extreme control over the Uyghurs in Xinjiang. Locals have been subjected to surveillance and even mass internment at the hands of the Communist Party. With these developments, the use of Xinjiang time could draw unwanted attention to locals, and Murshid fears it could invite reprisals from the authorities.
There might be a lot, maybe the majority of the Uyghurs at least switched their, you know, time on their watches or their phone to Beijing time just to avoid trouble.
One researcher we spoke to even raised the idea of these distinctions of time being weaponized. In 2014, assailants carried out an attack on a market in the city of Urumqi in Xinjiang, killing dozens and injuring almost 100. Both the where and the when of the attack were notable.
The perpetrators purposely targeted that market because it was a market frequented by Han people, and it was a market that appeared to open and close according to Beijing time.
Crucially, the attack occurred first thing in the morning, just before 8 a.m. Beijing time, or 6 a.m. Xinjiang time, which raises the possibility that the attackers chose the time to target Han Chinese and spare the Uyghurs.
Uyghurs wouldn't be up that early to go to a morning market, because it would have been about 6 a.m. Xinjiang time, but a very normal time for someone who was operating on Beijing time to go to a market.
It's not clear how imperiled Xinjiang time actually is these days. For now, it remains a curiosity that Murshid hopes will endure.
I think it will survive, but it's definitely under attack, and it's definitely threatened. But I'm hopeful. I think it'll survive.
So with these stories in mind, here's what we're not saying. That time zones are the cause of cancer, economic waste, and authoritarian abuses. But studying time zones does reveal larger societal issues, like our modern inability to go to bed at night. And it leads to a recommendation we heard over and over, that more flexibility in our daily schedules could do a lot of good. Allowing wiggle room within time zones, relaxing rigid work schedules, it's not a cure-all, but it will make for healthier and freer people.
I mean, if we all didn't have an external schedule to which we had to work to, we could all fall asleep when we can and want to, and wake up when we can and want to, and that would really be the real freedom.
Hey everyone, thanks for watching. I know we didn't cover daylight savings in this video, although there are a lot of feelings about that, but hopefully we'll cover that topic in March. As always, thanks for watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe.
Don't hold us to it.